Parental discretion is advised.
Oh, hi. Didn't see you there. Enjoying this wonderful pizza from Slice on Broadway, the people in Pittsburgh that provide good pizza, the podcasters.
Want to have your business or podcast featured on the show? Contact us at info@sorgatronmedia.com. Subject line, advertising.
Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show episode 464 for this April 7th, 2015. I'm Mike Sorgat, Sorgatron on the Twitters from the Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA, ready to talk professionalized wrestling. That's right. And we got a very special one here for you. First of all, let's go down the line. Coming at us from Poughkeepsie, New York is Mad Mike.
What up, Sorgo? Seeing it's my last 3 hours, I'll be in 31.
Oh, really?
Yeah!
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Celebrate with us on the Indie Mayhem Show later. Also with us from Johnstown, PA is Bobby F. J-Town.
I was messing with my penguin. I'm sorry. Hi, everybody.
It gets worn out on the good lines from
before. Talking about Nintendo and new Pokemon thing
the Pokemon's wore you out, right?
Yeah.
Also with us from San Antonio, Texas, he's the commentator for Inspire Pro Wrestling. He's Eamon to please Eamon Payton. How you doing?
I'm doing fantastic. I played my penguin before the podcast started.
No, it's not. That's not the kind of podcast this is.
Because I'm a professional. But hey, how's it going?
I'm playing with my penguin right now. He's right here.
Oh, stop. Different. Put your penguin away. Also, heck with us.
Watch that five hole.
After this month hiatus is DJ Lunchbox joining us. And what have you walked back into?
Hello, everybody. I'm back, and I'm so proud of all of you. You're already making dick jokes and penguins and everything like that. It's good to be back. I missed you all.
And also, we got a very special guest in studio. She's joined us before on the Indie Mayhem Show. She's from around the area. We might have seen her on some Sorgatron Media productions in the past. She's Sarah Feeney.
Hello, Feeney Army. Thanks for joining us tonight. Wait, Sorg, what? You didn't introduce my guest.
Oh, no. She's got the sting mask.
My tag partner. My new tag partner. Oh, wait.
That's creepy.
Where's the police?
Oh no! Oh no!
Oh, that's
right.
I'm sorry.
He's a Feeny
Mark. I keep confusing them. I didn't right know it was Sting because you didn't have any bongo drums.
That's what we're missing.
Bongo drums.
Bongo drums. Oh, it's been a while.
It's good to see some things have not changed on the show.
So it was about a year ago when you were on the Indie Mayhem Show. Oh, how you been doing?
I've been good, and I just wanted to share something with our guests here, if you don't mind. Can you zoom in there?
I can't see that. I can't see. That's LB in that picture. And is that a blow-up John Cena?
It is, and now you have graduated to Roman Reigns, which stares at me awkwardly this entire podcast. But I just am showing you guys this because Sorg is a Feeny Army member.
That's right. Oh, it's from the Carlin's party. That's right.
That's right.
Yes, and LB is there as well. Sure. I don't think that's the same party where we put you in a box for the Cena section.
No.
That was a different one.
I try to block out the memories still.
Awesome. Well, we got Sarah here.
Very dirty things happen in that box.
Oh, no.
We'll very sweaty away in that box.
Weren't there, like, toys in the box? I don't even want to get into that.
Wrestling figures.
Eventually there was. I think at one point I may have spilled a drink or something in the box.
Something. He wore it for the entire 3 hours of the pay-per-view, just a box with the opening. And it was the Cena section.
You have awkward friends.
Show title.
Awkward Friends. Welcome to the Awkward Friends cast.
I like you guys. You're cool. I like you. No worries. Awkward, but cool.
It's the Awkward Friend cast. You can join us here and be awkward with us live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com about 9 p.m. Eastern time. And join us in the chat room, just like our friends, like Riz is hanging out in there. Wheels, you know Wheels.
Hey, what's up, Wheels? It's been a while.
Everybody else that jumps in there for the night, Juggalo John, Brother Sorg's in there as well. And we keep an eye on that for anybody jumping in and see what's going on. You can also follow us at Mayhem Show on Twitter, of course. Wrestling Mayhem Show is .com and on Facebook, the great Facebook group. We have there's a lot of conversation going on today. What happened while I was busy? Holy crap. I love when I go in and something I didn't see several hours ago already has 45 comments. You guys get heated in there. And also,
we wanted to punch Garza.
No. And also, Wrestling Mayhem Show on the Google Plus as well. And you can subscribe to us, all the links at WrestlingMayhemShow.com, and support us on Patreon. Support us by checking out our shop over on Pro Wrestling Tees, Spreadshirt, great designs by the great Alex Kars. And speaking of Patreon, you can be our boss too, just like Ciro, WrestlingRevolution.com is one. And of course, Bo Diggity. And everybody has joined us in the past. Mike, are you still a Patreon? I can't remember. Did you?
I said I would support the show until WrestleMania.
Okay.
And I have done so. If I was employed, I would be continuing to support the so Patreon I love the extra little videos I would get.
Mad Mike, who's a part of the show, still contributing in to become the boss of us all because he needs more authority around here.
Yes.
And you can too, patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. You do get some extra stuff. And we're actually going to be kind of releasing this stuff from like a month ago, so you can kind of see what you get a first crack at. And thank you, everybody. I've actually been getting some great feedback from our Patreon supporters, and they're the ones that we're more in direct conversation about what's going on. They got to hear my tired rant about what was going on this morning as far as the state of the show and everything.
Can't wait to hear till I hear my peep review.
Your peep review that took you out of action for the rest of the night.
It took me out of a week of a podcast.
That's right. You could only hear Bobby if you were on gold that week, and then there was vomiting. So let's get into a first topic of the week. AJ Lee, of course, retires at the ripe old age of 28.
Must be nice.
I wonder what that pension's like. This is one of the reasons I messaged Sarah here, because we are having a great conversation about this with a bunch of dudes on a wrestling board. So I thought we'd get a little bit of insight in this. So the story is, was announced, I believe, last Thursday, and it was on WWE.com, retires from the ring, retires from WWE. That doesn't mean she's not going to do other things. Who knows? Maybe she'll just become a valet at UFC. Who knows? I don't know what her plan is.
For Ronda Rousey.
But no, I thought we'd go around the horn. Well, first, are you a fan, first of all, of AJ and the stuff she's done in WWE?
I'm a fan of any woman that works hard. Sorg, these headphones aren't very complimenting to a woman. I'm just saying, maybe some earbuds. Are you messing with my sound here? Anyways, I think maybe some pink earbuds, you know, would help. But
LB took them home last time.
LB. Gee whiz.
Mine broke. I'm sorry.
Gosh. All right. So AJ. So she started wrestling in 2007, right? When she started training, started wrestling, got signed after a tryout with WWE 2009.
She was part of the NXT season. Was that correct?
Season three.
That was later after the training, of course.
And so within that small amount of time, she has accomplished so much. Mm-hmm. She's a three-time Divas champion, two-time Diva of the Year. I mean, held the championship for 285 days-ish, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, that is some amazing accomplishments. So for the short time that she did have a career in wrestling, she did a lot of things and set a lot of milestones.
So this is my take on this, though, because it feels like, again, it's like, you know, she's retiring at 28 versus when we see other guys retire, unless it's, you know, the case of something like Edge where it's a neck injury, much like 40, you know, let's say that, or even longer in the case of somebody like a Shawn Michaels or Triple H still freaking going, right? And we look back at I think the other great examples of girls that have done great stuff in the last 20 years in wrestling are, for me, Lita and Trish. And again, I think looking at that shelf life of the Divas, and I don't know, is this a concern because, or is this a thing that happens because they're Divas? Like, what, you know, and, you know, you being in this field, you know, what is that kind of concern that, you know, you would only have maybe this long a span maybe in this, but it looks like they're all going willingly. Like I think they pretty much retired under their own, you know, motivation at that time, even for them.
Yeah, I mean, two things about this. Like, first, you know, women, they decide at a certain point that they want to maybe start a family, and mm-hmm. as a a woman, it's a lot harder to be on the road how many days a year, you know, after having a baby, wanting to be there for a baby. So, yeah, there, of course, is the human aspect of it, of what you want in life. Mm-hmm. But maybe she's, you know, at a place. Well, first of all, we all know how retiring in wrestling goes. I have seen on the indie scene myself, I have seen a handful of names.
It's kind of like, oh, I'm congratulations, you're retiring. See you in 3 months.
Exactly. It's like retirement almost- match this month, you know, comeback match next month. It's like, it's very short term a lot of the time. So, but, you know, I checked on her. She seems to be kind of getting interested in things outside of wrestling. She's doing some things for like adoption, like pets, you know, things like that. So she obviously is a worker. She's going to continue to work. She's not going to just sit home with her feet up. I just don't see her as that kind of woman. But, you know, it's just, you know, and two, I was thinking about this, like AJ, you know, she reached a certain height, you know, she did so well in such a short amount of time. And then it's like, you know, she gets married, she comes back, and it's like, will she ever reach that peak again? And sometimes people think, maybe I should, you know, just kind of go out while I'm on top, per se, instead of trying to drag things out. So they want them to be remembered as, you know, the best that they were at that time.
Well, leading to that, she did just have her match, a really good match at WrestleMania, not some, in my opinion, stupid invitational battle royalty thing like they had last year, right?
That's next week, sir.
What's that?
That's next week.
I see we're going back to the well on that one. But anyways, that's a battle royal, you know. But anyways, but that missed my other point now. Sorry, Bobby.
I'm sorry.
It's all right. But also, yeah, she also didn't, apparently the WWE wasn't aware she was about to go this direction. So I think it was very smart as far as that goes. But again, you know, I think there's also this kind of glass ceiling. I don't know if you watch Total Divas. We're all strangely addicted to it here around here. But I know like the Bellas.
Not all, sort.
Not all of us. Thank you. Thank you, Will. Thank
not
you.
All
of us.
There's one sane one in the bunch.
Sorry. All of us true wrestling fans are addicted to all every wrestling.
Aspect to it.
Total Divas, NXT.
Calling you out.
Network all day, every day. $9.99.
But anyways, that discussion is happening amongst the Bellas. You know, unfortunately, if one of them wants to get pregnant, that kind of affects the other one because they're kind of a package, right? But they're really kind of tackling those things that I think it sounds like that AJ is getting. And I think it's an unfortunate, we talk about like the topic going around is gender equality in the business. And it's definitely not there in the entertainment business across the board. It's not going to be because it's the entertainment business, unfortunately. But there's not really much further to go than where like Nikki is now, where AJ was for the longest time. Beth Phoenix was there on top and she left, you know. Is that, do you think, is it a WWE problem or is that a wrestling problem, you think? Or is it a problem?
What is the problem?
Kind of like
that, you lost me, like, sorry. I'm sorry.
That's the kind of peak and there's not really much more to go. And maybe that's why this shows a short span.
I think that WWE has changed a lot, and in the way that they allow their workers, wrestlers, superstars to go different directions in their career instead of only being WWE. You know, you maybe want to have a fashion line, or you know, want to do movies or whatever. If you want to do other things other than wrestling, that they allow you to do that, and using the WWE platform to build your fan base, build your name, you know. Mm-hmm. And go those different directions to chase your other dreams. So, you know, I just think it's up to the person in general. I mean, if you remember Trish Stratus, she went out on top too. But then it seemed like it was just a short time later and it was like Lita's retiring. And it was like, where did this come from? I didn't see it. Mm-hmm. I didn't see it. So, you know, and we know AJ Lee is a huge Lita fan. So to maybe she didn't want to be, you know, have that published in the
She'll be in the Hall of Fame in 3 years, you know.
Hall of Fame 3 years. Sure. She was different, you know, and that's what stuck. And so now someone's got to fill that void.
Or maybe it is because we do see a lot of girls coming up. I think, personally, I think, you know, between what's happening in NXT and what's there now on the main roster, I think we're getting a pretty good mix of, like, girls that can work up there.
Absolutely.
And put some good men. The Divas, give Divas a chance is happening and everything. Maybe it's time, maybe she was seeing everything getting flooded and everybody coming up and like, well, I'm out.
Maybe. Do you think that her wearing that Bayley shirt was a way for her to kind of, like, pass the torch to who she felt was was right to fill a position that she was going to leave open.
I also think towards her her slammy speech where she basically was like, there's going to be the Sasha Bankses and the Baileys and the Charlottes that are going to come up and hopefully take my spot. And I that's really interesting to look at now in retrospective. Like, that concept of there is a cycle of women that can, you know, rise to the occasion.
Mm-hmm. The thing about, like, when divas leave WWE, too, if it's not really their choice, sometimes they don't get the best exits. Like, yeah, we say Trish went out on top. Do you guys remember the last segment Lita was in? Because I do.
That was not great.
It was not great. It was Crime Time auctioning off a vibrator that was supposedly Lita's.
That was her way out?
Yeah, that was her last thing.
Wow.
Like, I mean, it's very AJ to just randomly announce on a Thursday when they're not taping, when WWE can't take advantage of it, that she's done.
She went out her way.
How'd that conversation go, you think? I mean, is there like is she at the right? Because is she at the right spot of her contract that she can be like, yeah, I'm taking this out, you know, or what, you know, or was she giving attention? She was re-signing and maybe just dropped the bomb at the last minute.
I mean, she also the elephant in the room. She also could be pregnant.
There was a picture that went out on Instagram. Wasn't it Emma, like kind of
no Bailey.
Bailey like kind of had a hand on her stomach, kind of like signing that, you know.
Well, yeah, I mean, but that came out before WrestleMania.
That was before WrestleMania.
It was a hug, essentially.
Okay.
But, no, she could have found out afterwards.
That's true.
Because like the Paige interview with Jericho on Talk Is Jericho, Paige said her mother was wrestling while she was pregnant. Paige's mother obviously didn't know at the time. Mm-hmm. But it could be a similar situation. We don't know.
Or, you know, maybe she realized she wasn't happy. She doesn't seem like a selfish person. And she realized, why am I taking a spot that someone else would die to have? Mm-hmm. Why am I keeping this opportunity for someone else that wants it? And I'm not happy, you know?
And I think going to like what Sorg said, there's the Women's Championship or the Divas Championship, whatever era it is. You know, how far a woman can go in the WWE is sort of a point to that. I mean, the shelf life is interesting of, you know, Trish, Lita as well, but also people like, you know, Eve Torres, who's only there for like 5 years, or Kelly, or, you know, so many others. They reach the pinnacle, and it's like, well, what do I do now? Do I just stay here?
Right.
And just stay at this top spot, or do I, you know, move on and try something else?
Go ahead. You also have to consider she's going to work every day and she's in this top spot. And instead of chanting her name, they're chanting her husband's name.
Yeah.
And she can look at that situation and she can also look at, you know, everything that's going on between her employer and her husband and everything like that. And then she can look at her bank account and say, I've been very smart with my money. I've held on to it. I'm in a good position right now. I can walk away from this and be fine. Mm-hmm. If I had the money to retire at 28, I would have. But I didn't have the money. None of us do. That's why none of us retired at 28, probably. I can't speak personally for everybody, but if I, you know what I mean?
Hey, you know, Eamon still has a chance over there. Eamon still has a chance, you know.
Yeah. Bobby's loaded. Everybody knows that. It's because he's loaded. He loves the work.
I'm going to Gail Kim roll right out of the ring.
So, Sorg, going back to, like, women's shelf life in wrestling and if you're happy or not, let's look at Natalya Neidhart, for example. I mean, you know, obviously she draws a different crowd than AJ. AJ just stuck out. She was different, whatever. Mm-hmm. Natalya, she's been wrestling since, like, maybe 2000, you know, so she's going on 15 years, debuted, like, roughly 2007. So Natalya has been, you know, I think personally I've met her and I've seen her work ethic, busting her butt, trying to be that next big thing in the women's division, that big impact, and is not getting the light that AJ was getting, and then AJ may not be happy. And so that's kind of where I was going with that too, and you're saying, you know, women's shelf life. Okay, well, Natalya's there just because she's not, you know, and, you know, whatever, doing things that AJ was doing, she's still busting her butt. And I think that she's, you know, going to be there until, You know, so she's been going for how long?
I think she's more. It says here she started training in 2000, came to WWE, of course, 2007. It was definitely been there longer. AJ didn't premiere until 2010 with season 3 of NXT. Okay. I know we all love that season. But yeah, that got weird.
And I also think. Oh, go ahead, Bobby.
How long has Rosa Mendez been
there?
consistently? Alicia Fox, I think, is technically the senior member.
Yeah, that's true, too. Mm-hmm. Yeah. She actually is really good at wrestling.
Here's the thing. Look at Alicia Fox. Look how long she's been there. And compare her to some of the other wrestlers and how long they've been there.
But I think there's also a stigma, and has been a lot of times with the Diva division of, because they haven't been giving them a chance. But there's also, you know, there were a lot of girls that really couldn't wrestle for a while, too. You know, your Kelly Kellys and stuff along the way. And,
hey,
you know,
Kelly could go.
Much like we fell into this gap where Bobby.
Kelly couldn't go into the ropes, Bobby.
Much like we go into the spot where like nobody can do a promo on their own and everybody has to be scripted and everybody's like, man, I'd love that we get back to that old, you know, the old way of doing that. You know, I think the Divas got to the same thing. You had your Trish and Lita, holy crap, Mickey James, you know, kind of thing. You fell into your Kelly Kellys and had a bunch of those.
And you still will. You still will.
It's going to be a cycle.
I mean, they're going to be doing a diva search. So that's the idea of it, right? Is to find the beautiful women that fill these spots for managers, whatevers, you know. But yes, you're right. They look for women with talent because they realize that professional wrestling is evolving. People are enjoying seeing women work good matches.
It angers me. I woke up Sunday because I fell asleep with the network on in my chair because my wife was away, so I can do that. I woke up to the first episode of Tough Enough. It just angers me so bad that the first one eliminated is now on Tilda Divas and all this other crap. It just makes me so mad. And then she does a Kamala pin. But anyways, other than that. But I mean, really, and that is kind of, you know, the way that they look at a football player and say, well, of course we can turn him into a wrestler. You look at a model in a diva search and, did that Carmella ever do a match? Did she just show up and do Playboy and that was it?
Fought, oh, no. Oh.
Carmella did something.
She
never wrestled.
No. Hey, and even Mendez,
she
I think,
had,
is
like,
a,
maybe a Playboy pillow fight.
Jeez. I mean, but that was the bar at that point. And unfortunately, I think the entire division was just painted with that, even though we had awesome Beth Phoenixes and stuff, you know? But I don't know.
I've been a professional wrestling fan my entire life, probably since I was about 4 years old.
And how long have you been in the business for those new?
Sure. I trained 2009 with IWC's training school. And then I had my first match in 2010. And Sonny was actually the special guest ring announcer. Mm-hmm. So that was pretty cool.
And I know you've been involved with matches. I know Gail Kim's been around. I forget who was the other. But Tracy Brooks.
It was a TNA. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you've been around and rubbed elbows with a lot of these people.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I've been locally here in Pittsburgh for those, you know, that may have seen me. I've worked IWC. I've worked RWA. Mm-hmm. I had one appearance for VOW. I now work Five Star. He runs bi-weekly, you know, about twice a month. So, and then I've been working a lot out of state too. So I held the ACW in Maryland. I've held their championship, women's championship. I'll be going to MCW here. I was up in Delaware. So yeah, so I have inquiries coming in from different states and it's great to be able to meet. I was at my last Delaware show. I was sitting backstage talking to JJ Dillon and to be able to get his insight and everything and actually exchanged emails with him afterwards and just told him thank you that I appreciated his time because, you know, to be able to take that time to give it to someone like me and tell me, you know, what you think I can work on and whatever like that, that was cool. But what I was saying is that, you know, being a wrestling fan all my life, I've seen women's wrestling evolve so much. Mm-hmm. Never did I imagine when I was younger and I was, you know, a fan of Shawn Michaels, Ken Shamrock, 1-2-3 Kid, people like that watching their matches happen. Never did I think that women would one day be selling merchandise, selling t-shirts, have their own reality show, you know, those kinds of things. I mean, it has just evolved and it's amazing. and people like it. And I read that, you know, people are enjoying Total Divas because they're showing their personality. So, you know, and I think that the wrestling world is just changing.
Mm-hmm. It's a reality era, as Triple H said, right? And I know we've talked about on the show, I think, you know, friends of ours have been getting into watching Raw, looking for that Divas segment because Total Divas, you know, mm-hmm. brought them into it. Mm-hmm. And there's so many more opportunities there. And even I think in the indies, I think it's amazing to see, like, I was excited that VOW last year did a women's show, which is the first I've known in the area. And of course, Cleveland, they do an AOW all the time. And you see in that, and you see entire promotions shine, shimmer, WSU, tons of other ones. They're just women's wrestling. And there's a lot of opportunity on that level, too, to find something. TNA does a knockouts only pay-per-view once a year, at least. Maybe twice, I don't know. And there is a lot going on there. It's obviously not just WWE, and even, oh, maybe HBO will pop up in some of these things.
I don't know if maybe it's because, I mean, I don't know, because I've only been doing this again since 2010. So I've only been exposed to so much. But, you know, maybe more women are becoming interested in it and realizing mm-hmm. that the dream is, you know, very possible to capture, kind of thing. But I think that people are seeing that there can be beautiful women that know how to wrestle and can have just as good of a match as some of the guys on the card. And I'm just saying that they realize they would rather see that than see maybe models that really don't know much about wrestling, maybe don't respect certain aspects of the business, or maybe not. Maybe. What do you think, Sorg?
That was a wide brush there.
I try to be optimistic.
Right, yeah. Right. No. And I think there's a lot of that. And I think it's really cool to see that. And it's really good. I was really, and I go back to this, and we talked about this on the indie show, but this is more of a state of women's wrestling conversation. But I was really excited because I saw Exotic Women of Wrestling was on the card for Juggalo Championship Wrestling in the Gathering. I'm like, oh, it's going to be a bunch of strippers in the ring, isn't it? Thankfully, I went, and it was wrestlers. Legit. It was Cherry Bomb. It was, I can't remember all the names. It was one, we talked to a couple of them on the show, Eamon, if you can help me with names here.
Dyslexia. I think going back to like what Zorg said about like that whole, it kind of is the same thing with the males in a sense of like, well, we're going to get like a football player or somebody from like that athlete world and make them a wrestler instead of just hiring a wrestler. Like I think that's just more of WWE's mentality of growing their own stars, I guess. It's been effective. There's plenty of women that I think on the WWE main roster that didn't go into this originally as going into it because they were a wrestler first or whatever, that are still having, I think, good matches and being successful. I just feel like it's going back to it, just the whole portrayal thing and what they give them and going back to it, like the opportunities they give them. Is there more they can get than just, you know,
yeah,
you know, a match on a show.
Yeah, and of course, I mean, there are definitely models, beauty pageant winners that can be athletic and be good wrestlers. I actually am friends with a woman named Renee Michelle, and she is amazing in the ring. And she started mm-hmm. as a model, same as Mandy Leon from, you know, I'm not personally, you know, friends mm-hmm. with Mandy or anything like that. She's an amazing worker, and she started as a model. And so, and I just know that by reading about her. Yeah, and so did Trish, you know. So you can definitely, you know, transform. I appreciated having a talk with Regal one time not too long ago. I won't disclose the location. Anyway, and he was telling me that kind of what they're looking for now is people with a bigger fan base, you know, going after people that are known for other things, maybe like, I don't know if I can say like soccer player and stuff like that.
That's bringing like a crossover appeal. Yeah. Much like how Brock brings all these UFC fans
right.
over.
Right.
Ronda Rousey? Ronda Rousey's going to bring all these UFC people over, so yeah, I can definitely see that.
But I think that I think the good thing that's being shown is that there is a demand, like kind of what you mentioned, like the fact that, you know, women's merchandise is selling really high on shop, and I think even AJ mentioned like the women are usually one of the highest rated segments on the show. They have, you know, the success of Total Divas alone, like there's a demand for women in professional wrestling.
And maybe that's why she was so vocal going out the door about the Give Divas a Chance a few weeks ago, right?
Yeah,
so she just burned the place down on the way out and left it hopefully better.
I wondered if when she came back with that whole angle, if she would be feuding with Stephanie, but maybe they weren't going that direction?
You know what? I don't know anymore. I've talked about this before on some of the other shows. I think WWE is at this point where, much like we really loved being fooled before when, you know, Attitude Era, you didn't know what was going to happen. I think social media is that playground now. So I think stuff like that, I think there's as much of that stuff that you hear about, like the AJ Lee comments about give women a chance, that's real and enough that are planted and enough that are a mix of work shoot, if you will. That I think that's where we're looking at tweets and we're just like, wait, was that for real? Was that supposed to happen? Like even like the Darren Young thing where he talked about them going to Arab Emirates, you know, they let him do it. That we know of, he's obviously not being put down. He's doing great stuff and getting a spot on Raw, you know?
Well, so like Cena said last night on the podcast with Jericho, taking chances,
right?
You know, not being afraid to do rewarded. Things.
And they love seeing that when you do it and it works out, you know, right. You gotta be not afraid of things.
And I still think we're going to see somewhere down the line a CM Punk and AJ versus Stephanie and Triple H match.
That would bring in so high of ratings, so much
WrestleMania
money.
WrestleMania 33. I was saying for the longest time when Bryan was champion, I want to see Brie and Bryan versus Steph and Triple H.
Mm-hmm.
But CM Punk and AJ makes 10,000 times more sense.
Especially consider that after CM Punk has had a run in UFC and been a draw mm-hmm. over there, and then to come back again to the WWE, that would be insane.
They've mm-hmm. discussed this
because then he would get the part time run that he always kind of
right.
wanted. It seems he wanted the same respect that The Rock got when he did his part time run. Mm-hmm. The Rock does when he does his part time stuff.
JR talks about this on his podcast. I think around the CM Punk situation that WWE is really good. This is kind of a company thing. WWE is really good about like letting people go and hiring them back at four times the cost as consultants. And that's what they do with Jericho. That's what they do with The Rock. That's what they will maybe one
but
day
why?
Do with CM Punk.
But why? Because they bring in money. They bring right. in ratings.
Right. Right, because they come back and they came back or they
it's
did something
business.
Else. Jericho's going around doing Fozzy. There's your crossover there. Rock's doing Holy Crap Furious 7. He's going to come back in a few months, say hi, have a cup of coffee, and they just bumped up the ratings on Raw and he gets his money, right? And he's the
Batista in Guardians of the Galaxy.
Batista, Guardians of the Galaxy, exactly.
They haven't brought him back yet, necessarily.
Dude,
no, I can see it happening.
When they bring him back, I hope he doesn't understand metaphors. I just hope he does. Like, I just hope that's a new wrinkle of his character. Someone says, "I'm going to kick your ass," and he's like, "Just my ass?" That seems kind of insufficient.
Like, just comes out full makeup,
or like he goes against Taker. Taker goes like this. Why would you put your finger to your throat? That doesn't make any sense.
Bobby, you seem quiet over there.
I do.
Yes.
My phone rang and I had to mute my.
Oh yeah. Other than that. Any thoughts before we move on to another topic here?
I just think it's good for AJ that she stepped out when she went out on her terms. I wish we all could do that.
As Bobby gets reflective on his own life and career.
But
it's okay, man. We still got this podcasting thing could take off. We got a chance.
Yeah.
So.
Sounds good.
All right. With that, I want to take a quick break, and we'll have more here with Serafini, and then later on with our big question, the big return with Papa Lunchbox. Glad to see him back on here. But in the meantime, hey, go support our friends. Serafini, for instance, is on some of this stuff over at PittsburghWrestling.com, and yeah, you can check out some of her best stuff. You know, taking on the likes of Sassy Steph, for instance. I know we got
Sassy
in there.
Steph. We got Sassy Steph. We got Casey Carlisle, Jesse Bell, Madison. Hopefully soon, Ray Lynn. I'm coming after you, girl. So yeah, YouTube Italian Diva AS, Twitter Serafini SERA. Come on, guys. Facebook, Instagram.
There's that one time you were in a battle royal.
Are you talking about IWC?
Yeah, I'm talking about that.
Do you remember how I got out of the battle royal?
Yeah.
Do you? How was it?
It wasn't.
Yeah. John McChesney, if John McChesney, if you're listening, I have not forgot. You super kicked me out of the battle royal. I think he was intimidated. I'm pretty sure. I think I smacked him first, so it might have contributed. But yeah, I showed up and I told Chuck, I was like, put me in this. Put me in this. I'm not afraid of these guys. And boom. But if you watch the footage, I did kick some butt before I left.
Yeah, she did. You can check that out. That's one of the combat and clear fields, I think, 4-5-ish, something like that, if you want to check that out. PittsburghWrestling.com, all kinds of fun stuff, and including, if you want to see ladies wrestling, VOW has, like I said, that ladies show from last year. I think it's Vixen Mayhem was the name of the show, if you want to check that out. And all kinds of other fun stuff coming up there. I think there might be a women's title coming from one of the other sources that we have coming in over there. And you check out other stuff like finding Zach Gowen. Zach Gowen, by the way, Instagrammed. He's apparently did some kind of DDP yoga challenge, and dude is looking ripped. He's never looked that good.
He's amazing. He's an amazing, awesome, inspirational story.
He's the coolest dude I've met in wrestling. Sorry, Fleck. we got a lot of great stuff there. Go check it out. Montreal Theory, all kinds of fun stuff. Support International Wrestling Cartel. Support indie wrestling in general. Anything you pick up there is super appreciated by myself supporting this show and everything else. And the guys themselves. The money goes to the promotions themselves as well. So with that, let's get into topic number two, and this includes a little bit of the diva search we were talking about. New fall season, even though it's spring. Actually, some of these are spread out throughout the year. We got our first kind of view at this at WrestleMania. They ran a commercial for WWE Network, and we're going to get diva search. It was just announced Tough Enough actually is going to be on USA. SmackDown is moving to USA. USA is the wrestling channel now. It's like WWE Network.
No longer suits, ladies and gentlemen.
No more suits.
Oh, but they're still going to have sirens, though. Can't forget about sirens.
We're going to bring back the silk stockings. You watch it.
Yes.
La Femme Nikita, let's do this. Bring it back to the 90s, guys. But
USA Up All Night, hosted by
Ronda Shearer.
Rosa Mendez.
Rosa Mendez. There you go.
Oh, Bobby, no.
Rosa Mendez and Santino Morello. It would be tremendous.
I was going to say Gilbert Gottfried again, but okay.
Why not? Why not? But they got a whole lineup here. They're going to have an adult TVMA Seth Green pushed Camp WWE cartoon.
Why do a cartoon that's MA?
Because they can?
Archer.
Archer, there you go.
Maybe it's because I feel like it's because of the fact that it's on the network. Maybe they're leaning towards a more adult audience. I mean, maybe not.
But if I have a kid and he turns on the network and it's a cartoon, he's totally watching it.
That's true.
And that's why you use parental controls.
But there's also parental controls.
Yeah.
So can I unlock that parental control to watch it?
No, Bob, you don't know my password.
Okay.
And this is why.
You ruined everything.
Bobby, is that a dog in the background?
That is my cat.
Oh, okay. Hi.
That's Penny.
We had the dog on the last show.
Okay.
But no, I think, to that, why are they doing this MMA stuff? Because they got that. They got the Jerry Springer Too Hot for TV. Wasn't there another one they're doing that's kind of more risque?
Didn't the Jerry Springer thing seem just like a clip show, though?
It's going to be a clip show with Jerry Springer. It's completely what it's going to be. But they're going to show that old stuff they can't show anymore because it was Attitude Era when they were allowed to do that, of course. And bloody stuff and who knows what else. It's going to be like... I don't know. It's going to be like, hey, remember the stupid thing? They're going to do the chopped a wee-wee thing, you know, and those kinds of scenes. And Jerry's going to, of course, is going to watch them for the first time, react. I don't know. But it's an interesting way to resurface that stuff. And, I mean, they can make, I don't even know how many clip shows, like WWE Countdowns and WrestleMania rewinds and everything, and just reuse all that content they're sitting on and resurface it a little bit. It's actually a good strategy.
Not even just the WWE stuff. They have... Do you remember all the crazy shit that happened in WCW?
That's true, too.
And ECW.
Yeah. Jesus.
That's true. Uncensored ECW stuff, it would go perfectly there.
The kimono went away, the ECW arena.
You have that.
I'm hardcore. I'll take them both.
You have that. You have the Camp WWE. You have the Camp WWE that's TVMA. You're filling that audience that wants the Attitude Era back. By one, reliving the Attitude Era, maybe the stuff they didn't see in the Attitude Era to begin with.
A lot of it's very much like Attitude Era content too, like the stuff that they you know, put out there is more for that sort of generation of wrestling fans, I feel.
It is.
Those, I feel like those are that's the main audience buying the network. They're, you know, the adults now who grew up on this stuff. They have the money to spend, and they want to relive their childhood.
They're super serving those people that want those things, you know.
Yeah.
You can get in there and see that. You can get in there and see, you know, Triple H has admitted that the NXT fan base is a hardcore fan base that are paying $9.99. And no matter what they say, no matter how much they push it, is the hardcore that's going to put down that money.
I think so.
Like, easily. You know, the people that aren't dissuaded by seeing Raw every week and like, it's not for me anymore, you know.
Have you guys ever been to an NXT show?
No,
nobody here, but our friends, the Carlins, have. Yeah. You have been? Yes.
I have
you
been.
You guys have?
Let's take a round of I've been. And you know what? It is such a different atmosphere.
Is it? Okay. How close does it just feel like an indie show with a budget?
It is very similar. Because Yeah, it's so similar because the fans know all the chants. They know. I mean, they're on it. They are, like, definitely keyed into the show.
Now I wonder what's going to happen when they travel more. There was the show they did before WrestleMania. I thought was flat crowd wise. I didn't think the crowd was into it. I just, there was no feel to it. I thought.
The show they did before WrestleMania was back. Are you talking about the Cleveland one or the one right before WrestleMania? Because that was at back at Full Sail.
No, they did one the week of WrestleMania. Wait, no, it wasn't the club.
It wasn't there on the road thing, was it?
With Owens and Finn Balor?
Yeah, I thought that was from there. I thought that was live there from. That was Cleveland.
That was the last show they were taping.
Yeah, technically, those were filmed out of order.
Usually,
The Cleveland one was filmed after those shows, right?
Well, they film like 3 or 4 shows.
Right.
Because that's where I went. I went to Full Sail.
Right.
And so they have them weeks in advance.
Yeah. They did a weird mix up thing because I know the one last week, obviously, they had no time to tape that in between all these other Cleveland ones or anything. But no, I thought the one before was a live one from somewhere in California.
No. It was the last one with Balor Owens was from Full Sail.
Okay.
And it was at the very end of the taping. Yeah. So usually they actually, the crowds are kind of dead around that.
They actually advertised it. They advertised that this week the NXT, they're going to show the one from Access.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
So that should be an insane crowd.
Right, because there's a bunch of people that want to see it.
They were chanting NXT.
And even the Columbus one, the crowd was there and into it, and they drew a crazy crowd. And there was a lot of comment on, like, no, people are here to see these guys. They're not here to see Triple H as much as they're here to see these guys, and they have their own fan base. And I think it's pretty tremendous. And we're seeing, like, guys like Neville popping up and doing tremendous stuff already. So, let's go down the list a little bit more on this. Like I said, Tough Enough is coming back. It's going to be more interactive.
Is it true Austin's not going to be on Tough Enough?
Yeah.
That breaks my heart. Austin,
he
please.
Was great.
Did his podcast come out today?
Yeah, his podcast explaining what's going on with Vince McMahon. I didn't get to check notes or listen to it. I didn't have a chance to.
I haven't read a thing about it.
No.
Also, Bill Namath's not going to be on Tough Enough.
Oh, no.
Darn it.
All right,
No, that's fine.
Skype standoff. Skype standoff. Go ahead, Naaman.
Well, no, I was going to say, I really do, I'm upset of Austin not hosting, because if anyone's watched either the first season of Tough Enough or anyone that's watched Broken Skull Challenge,
mm-hmm.
He's probably one of the greatest reality show competition hosts.
And honestly, that shows probably why he's not doing Tough Enough.
That is why. Because he said something, I read it about, was supposed to film February, March or something, and now it got pushed back. So, of course, it interferes with
his... It is a scheduling thing.
Yeah, okay. And not that he wouldn't want to. He would love to in an ideal world, but his schedules conflict.
Yeah, that makes sense. That definitely makes sense. And he's got a lot of... He's building his own brand outside, you know. Maybe not so much movies, the reality show, the podcast, everything like that. So, you know, good for him.
So who would we want to see replace him as host?
Wow, who could... Triple H.
I got one.
Triple H
has his hand in so many...
I know. But he would be... I was watching...
He's too busy.
Because I've been trying to go through the first season of Tough Enough.
Regal. Oh, Fleck. Fleck. Regal's nice. Oh, yeah. Can Fleck come over and say
yeah,
hi?
Yeah, you can come over.
Fleck. Come on. Come on. Over and say hi. Come on. All right.
There's room on the couch. It's all right.
He doesn't want to share a couch with me, so instead you guys get to see my other tag partner. Look at his hair.
What do you think, Sting?
Oh, that one.
Sting says that.
Or you yes, know who'd be Sting said he should do it. Regal might never do it.
Sorry, Eamon.
Sorry, Eamon. Taker. I was going to say Taker would be good, too.
Yeah.
No, you're good.
There's I don't
weird,
see that.
There's a weird delay happened. Thing happening, which is why we're crossing over. But Regal is a good one. Apparently, he's actually going to be taking over at the Performance Center. Goldust, mm-hmm. I think, would be really kind of cool. I don't know if he would be as controversial or as, like, sort of, like, hard-nosed as, like, an Austin or somebody like that. But I feel like he'd be a good, like, one of the trainers that
yeah,
you would have
yeah.
on there.
Because you need a marquee guy, unfortunately. And Regal's not that. I mean, Bobby, what would you want?
My choice would be, he's probably busy, but I would say Jericho.
Probably
he would be decent because he hosted that robot fighting show.
I don't think he'd be tough enough. I think he could put Booker T maybe in the tough spot.
Oh.
I think he could put Booker T. You could put Booker T in that top spot.
Oh, Booker T, yeah.
Maybe
you know who
JBL.
I'd like to see? Huh. Is Bret Hart.
4 out of 10.
No, you just give everyone a 4 out of 10.
You
could
do a good job.
You give everyone
no,
a 4 out of 10.
No, I don't think Bret is good at anything right now.
Jimmy Hart.
Jeez.
I'm sorry.
Actually,
he's not.
No, guys, we're missing the most obvious person.
Piper!
Oh, jeez.
Second most obvious person. Dusty Rhodes.
I thought about Dusty, but the reason I didn't say it is just because I don't know if they want someone that's like going to get in there and be, you know, not that he can't, because I'm sure Dusty Rhodes could kick him my butt, but I'm just saying I thought maybe they would want someone that is going to actually get in there and like, you know.
Every elimination is a bull rope challenge.
Ricky the Dragon Steamboat.
Oh,
yes.
Steamboat's apparently doing a lot at the Performance Center. So
good.
Norman Smiley.
Well, what if it just becomes the trainers? I mean, at least for the
say
backups.
Fucking Norman Smiley.
He's a trainer in NXT.
Well, no, I'm with you. But what if you fill out the rest of that crew? You have one head guy like that Stone Cold position. You have Norman Smiley, Sarah Del Rey, and who's the other one that's in there now?
A-Train?
Yeah. A-Train could be in there.
Yeah, Jason Albert.
Or even Graves, Jason maybe, Albert. You know?
I was going to say that. What about Sarah Del Rey? What
Sarah
is
Del
she?
Rey would be a good one.
I would love to
I
see
mean,
her do like the last like promo class.
Oh, yeah.
She just gets in the face of everybody.
Yeah, I think that'd be great. I don't know, but they'd have to do a bit. They have the library, everybody except for Sarah Del Rey, actually, for those guys, so they can introduce them. And we've had Bill DeModel over this stuff, and what the hell did he do in WWE, right?
DDP.
DDP would be probably
that
a good
would,
one.
That would be good.
He gets my ass moving on yoga. So
you do DDP yoga.
Oh, yeah.
Good.
I actually just
work.
Got DDP yoga for
it's good stuff.
My birthday, so I'm going to be starting that too.
Get that working. Get that working. The wife is on it. The wife has a mix of John Cena's 10-week challenge and DDP yoga. So she's doing good. Anyways. Actually, side note, go to boldpittsburgh.com, and there's actually an article about her 10-week challenge with John Cena, if you want to find out more about that. And I think she's going to be probably putting that over on the other sites, too.
Hi, Miss Sorg. Hi, Mrs. Sorg. Hi. She's a good baker.
Yes, she is.
Oh, man. Yes, I think I'm going to have to unfollow her on Facebook because
there's so much healthy stuff.
Yeah,
my relatives were cursing her. We shouldn't get into this. This is another thing.
Okay.
Hey, hold on. There's
going
okay.
Back,
first
wait,
of all,
going back.
Go back and then I want to go forward.
It wouldn't be a thing unless Riz said the Great Khali, and he did in the chat room. Yeah. For tough enough.
I'd be okay
could
with
you
that.
Imagine that final promo class of Khali? I don't hear you talking.
What did he didn't he tweet just to say hi to Jericho last night? Or something?
Yeah, he said hi, bro.
Hi, bro.
It was the best.
I loved. I'm sorry. Side note. I loved hearing Cena talking about all the people that he traveled with,
like the Tajiri spot.
Him and Tajiri and all these other guys, and him and Carano and Cole apparently just go to bar, be angry, and talk about things. And this is them.
Well,
you know?
John Cena saves marriages.
John Cena saves marriages.
He saves marriages.
Just couldn't save his own.
Oh, Sorg.
Save that Wiz Khalifa marriage.
Save that Wiz Khalifa marriage.
They should have never let Wiz Khalifa split with his wife.
Nope. But back to it. Back to this list. First of all, I'm excited. Hulk Hogan's Rockin' Wrestling. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Although I was jealous because I think I saw, was it Gregory Iron that had a picture? Somebody got him one copy of Rock and Wrestling for his birthday. So real jealous of you, Gregory Iron. More rivalries, more countdown, more this stuff. Culture Shock with Corey Graves. Check out the description. Corey Graves reveals a variety of unique venues, customs, music, food, people as WWE tours travel. It's a travel show with Corey Graves. Nice. Did you expect that? Unfiltered with Renee Young is more interviews the superstars over pop culture, celebrities, covering just about everything, including Renee's guests include Grammy Award winner Wiz Khalifa, Skylar Gray, Roman Reigns, and Seth Rollins. So that's coming up in May. Live with Chris Jericho is now going to be a monthly thing. Because Stone Cold was a little too raw for them. Jerry Springer is actually popping up here at the end of April. I saw a date on one of these articles. I apologize. April, like 27th, I think I saw. Divas Search, of course, is coming up in the fall. And Swerved. We didn't talk about this. Speaking of that 90s Attitude Era thing, how about like the director of Bad Grandpa and Jackass doing a show, doing a prank show? Is this not the worst time to work in the backstage for WWE? Because you're going to be interviewed for a travel show. You got this unfiltered thing about pop culture you get to be a part of. And you're worried about a prank that can actually be put on TV. And
you have to dodge the Total Divas cameras.
And to dodge the Total Divas cameras and walk around without your pants on. But... I don't know. Any final thoughts, Sarah? I know we're at the end of our time with you here.
No final thoughts. This has been interesting, guys.
What's coming up for you?
Oh, geez, what's coming up for me? So, again, big debut at MCW in Maryland. I'm very excited. I'm going after the women's title there. So, everyone, look out. Come to the show. Follow them. Twitter, Facebook, also Five Star Wrestling, hopefully going back to 1CW in Delaware here soon, maybe making my way down south. So anyways, just follow me online, social media, and find out where I'm going next.
It's at Sarah Feeney, of course, on the Twitters. You're on YouTube as well. And if this
Chachi made over, that video.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Chachi made that.
He made that little package for me, yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, look at that shoe right to the... throat or Casey Carlisle.
There you go. Go check her out. What's the website?
Twitter, Facebook, Sarah Feeney, YouTube, Italian Diva AS, Instagram, Sarah Feeney. All things social media.
Check her out. She's a friend of the show, and you can check out our interview we did with a year ago with her. I know you weren't a fan of it.
Oh, I was so nervous. I apologize.
Oh, it happens.
I was really nervous.
I'm like, why are people nervous coming on this show? I mean, look at the surroundings.
I know, and I've known you for...
This is not a big studio, you know?
I've known you for how long, but it was just my first, like, on-camera live interview, and
It's weird. Knowing these youngins, when they were trainees, pulling cord for us.
I was pulling cord for you. Good times. Good times, Sork. I'm glad that we've grown.
And then he got replaced by that guy that left wanting to leave the building after I yelled at him.
Why do you yell at him?
Because I tripped over him. He didn't know where the hell to stand out there.
Then I sat next to you and played music for a while.
That was good.
A couple years.
We got good times. Good times out there.
Good times. Good time. Thank you, everybody, for having me. Feeney Army, thank you very much for tuning in and watching the playback on YouTube, right, Sorg?
You'll be on YouTube and, of course, on iTunes and all the places with audio and video. So can't wait to get that out there to people. Thank you very much for
everyone
chiming in on the women's wrestling situation. So in the meantime, for you guys supporting the show, I want to also support the people that are supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with pizza at Slice on Broadway, sliceonbroadway.com. Good friends of the show, great gourmets from scratch stuff, and really cool to have them be a part of the show and donating one of these guys every week to help our guests. It's dinner time usually when most people come through here for Awesome Cast, Boss Battle, or whatever, what have you, and they help us out. They're right down the tracks here in Beachview in the South Hills of Pittsburgh, and right here, and Carnegie, PA on Main Street as well. And check them out, sliceonbroadway.com. PJH_Slice on Twitter, and of course Slice on Broadway on Facebook and Instagram, and let them know that the Wrestling Mayhem Show sent you. We'll be right back with DJ Lunchbox with his bigger, badder, bigger question. I said bigger twice.
Question is same size. Same size question.
This is the Iron Sheik. You listen to the Mayhem Show. Iran, number one. Russia, number one. USA,
he is the Wrestling Mayhem Show, and it is time for that biggest of big questions, or maybe just a regular size question ish. I'm not sure anymore.
It's probably going to be regular size.
Probably a regular size.
Fun size question.
He's back. He's got the question. LB, did we do a serviceable job without you with the big questions?
I think you guys did an excellent job.
Excellent. So what do you? You
did
what do
tremendously.
What do you got for us this week?
You know what my favorite part of the big question is?
The part where it's over?
No.
Asking the question?
No. My favorite part of the big question is that I don't have to sing a theme song for it anymore. That's great.
Not yet.
Although I think we should record like an official one.
Yeah, we should.
Okay, so professional wrestling as a whole, we know this from an outside perspective. We speculate on the sport, right? That's just how it is. That's just the nature of the beast. You got to speculate. Why? Because there's not a lot of transparency in professional wrestling. We know more than some people do because some people here work in professional wrestling. Some of us here have worked for the WWE before. So we know a little bit more than the average bear, which doesn't know shit because bears have tiny little walnut-sized brains. I don't know if you knew that, but that's why bears shit in the woods. And that's why they have the saying, does the Pope shit in the woods? Now,
don't make fun of bears.
Shit! God damn it!
Welcome back, LB.
That bear had a family!
I didn't know where I was going with that.
Sorry.
Let's see here. Bears. Pope.
Pope D'Angelo De Niro. TNA.
All right, okay, so wrestling as a whole, it didn't invent it. I don't know the origins, the etymology of the word, but it popularized the term kayfabe. And kayfabe, at his heart, means keep up your character and keep up the lie. Wrestling is an industry based on secrets. When Vince McMahon came out and said, yes, some of the things we do is staged, people fucking shit a brick in the wrestling world. A lot of other people were like, I knew it. And everyone else is like, you're not that fucking smart. My question, this nature of wrestling is slowly changing with social media and with the internet and everything like that. We're getting more and more of a behind the scenes look at professional wrestling, and they're really starting to embrace it to a certain degree. But as Sorg mentioned earlier on this very episode, you still don't really know if a tweet is genuine or if it is a work or what the deal is. Now, my question, my big question to you gentlemen here assembled here on the Wrestling Mayhem Show is, what if suddenly there was complete transparency in professional wrestling? If there were there was a website that suddenly cropped up like ESPN.com, where if they reported something, it was 99% true. Complete transparency in professional wrestling, how would that change the business? And how would that change this show? That's the big question.
The show?
This very show, the Wrestling Mayhem Show.
Wow. Wow.
I will answer quickly.
Okay.
How it would change the business, there would be, I think there would be a lot of changes in the practice, a lot of the ways that that wrestlers are treated backstage, and it might even change, you know, the locker room culture that they have and things like that. And especially if, you know, merchandise sales and salaries suddenly become complete public knowledge, you know, that's going to change a lot there. And on top of that, as far as this show is concerned, I think this show at that point improves. There's less speculation and there's more room for us to just lay back and enjoy and bask and soak in the thing that we love so well.
Good
point.
That's my answer.
I will combat that with, I think your coverage will be more interesting. You'll, of course, we're already seeing this a little bit, but stuff being covered, of course, on ESPN, especially around WrestleMania. I think you'll have more. The more I think things will change in the content, I think things would stay the same. Because have you looked at reporting and everything on Real Sports? Have you looked at hockey blogs? Have you looked at baseball blogs? I think as a whole, all those will be there. But I feel like what you're going to get is still based on speculation. Because I think, you know, not being a frequenter of sports blogs, I did love, I was entertained greatly, mostly because they have wrestling gifts every once in a while, the Pence blog. And a lot of it was perception and feeling, regardless of this is a real sport with press conferences, right?
Mm-hmm.
To that point, are you saying that it's like 99% exposed as regular sports are, or
no? It's complete transparency.
More than professional sports.
More than professional sports. Yes.
Okay. Then
because there's, like you said, there is still a lot of speculation and everything like that. But essentially, you're kind of taking a lot of the speculation out of the equation.
Right. I think, again,
or do you think that people would still speculate and not believe what they're being told?
Yes. I think the people that go off and make stories, well, the word on the street is the feeling backstage is da 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 da. That's still going to be a thing. Only maybe that'll actually be discussed on a version of an ESPN that cares about wrestling, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's you know, we kind of sit here and think like, oh, this is a sport and this and that, it should be treated the same way as this. It's not, guys. It's a stage show. Mm-hmm. It's mm-hmm. theater. What we're doing here on this podcast is no different than somebody that has a Soap Opera Digest podcast.
Which, mm-hmm. coming next week.
Coming next week from Sorgatron Media. And to that extent, I think, but to how the show changes, I think because those news sources won't change too much, I would only hope, the only difference I would hope is more credible news sources step up the report on it than we have now. Because unfortunately, let's be honest, some of these are freaking dirt. They are dirt sheets. And they make no sense. What?
Sorry.
The websites that we follow are just complete dirt. And there's a few credible ones. And even then, it's like, well, where did you get these from? You know? And it's all rumor and speculation. And I don't know. I don't think you're going to have, like, it doesn't make sense to me that, you know, you would have WWE have a press conference about, I don't know about Stone Cold and Vince having issues. You know what I mean? I mean, mm-hmm. I think we already have that to an extent because of all these people that have podcasts, and they're like, "Well, actually, this is how it is." Like, I think we do have our transparency, regardless of WWE having a hand in it or not. So, did I answer both sides of the question?
Yeah, I think so.
I think so. Yeah. Who wants next?
I think the website's going to be run by Mets Fan Forever or whatever that is. And it's going to be right 90% of the time. And it's going to be based on Reddit. Yeah. No, I think it'll change it for the best if that happens. It'll be more professional.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe WWE.com could become this one day. Who knows? Awesome. And that reality era that they're talking about. So we'll see. I don't think it'll change our show much.
No.
I think that if there was like real transparency of what was going on backstage and stuff like that, I think that would aid towards getting the wrestlers a union.
Mm-hmm.
Because, I mean, if you're talking like it's going to be more like sports, like the MLB players have a union, the NFL players have a union, like, if wrestling was truly transparent, we knew exactly what was going on with why this guy wasn't on this show, how, like, injuries that these people have, and how bad they really are off sometimes. Like, I think it might mean less house shows because of the transparency. And I think it might mean that more people will take time off, or we might get, like, not a season format, but something like where we get a few less shows, definitely less pay-per-views a year. Like, I think more transparency would benefit the product because people would be able to get into it a little bit more because they know kind of what goes on backstage and what goes into it.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd be able to look at it from a completely different perspective. And presumably, the WWE wouldn't be treating their fans like idiots anymore, mm-hmm. because they have all this extra knowledge.
Kind of kind of a side note to what you say, I would on the union side, I would love WWE to have a mandated for health reasons, like maybe a 9 months on the road, three off for everybody. Mm-hmm. Like I feel like they need to for personal, mental, and physical health. I think that's something that needs to happen. And plus,
it would help push new stars too.
It would give room to push new stars. You don't have to wait till everybody get injured. Miz is talking about, I couldn't wait. I was so happy I got injured because I can have time off the road and refresh myself and refresh my gimmick, right? But I don't know. That's kind of a side question. But I think it's needed, and you can stagger.
And plus, you could have more people do more side projects like movies and stuff.
Do side projects like that, and it's not like they need to go away for 3 months. Yeah. They can still do appearances and stuff, but they're not doing the whole boom, boom, boom that everybody has to do every week.
So. Like, that's when they should do charity work tours.
Yeah, sure. Something easy, you know? We're like, at least you're doing this. Like, oh, heal up, you know? Everybody needs it because, like, CM Punk, you're throwing yourself at the mat every night, you know? And you need to. You just really need to. I think that would help a lot of people out for longevity of their careers. I don't think
it would really change the show as much. I think we'd still be fucking awesome. So
there you go. Eamon?
As far as the business goes, I guess I'll garner it to more just WWE. I think the audience in which they focus on would be changed. I mean, we talk about how a lot of the cases when we talk about WWE, there's this kind of, well, it's not really for us. It's for a younger audience, someone who may not always know how scripted or how, you know, in-depth wrestling is. I think with transparency like that, there would be a more they would garner their attention more towards the audience that knows that it's fake or knows that it stays or you know, all those aspects, but still watches it because they either enjoy the athleticism or the storytelling or whatever it may be, because in theory, like, that would be your audience pretty much. It would also, I think, hold WWE more accountable on certain aspects, and I think that's for the greater good, definitely. As far as our podcast goes, I don't know if it would directly affect us. I do think there would be much fewer shows garnered towards wrestling, because, you know, if you have an ESPN-esque thing that is covering what's going on, you really only need one source, I guess, is the best way to put it. Unless, you know, there would be opinion pieces and stuff like that, but I think people are going to direct their attention more towards, you know, the news of whatever, you know, going on, I guess. I think it would definitely change up the podcasts, you know, internet sort of news realm, but I don't know if it would directly, like, hurt us, I guess. But yeah.
Awesome. I think that's everybody here along here, right?
Riz is
here. I'm sorry. I don't have him here in a slot. I apologize for that, Riz.
Sure. This is the second time now.
Yes.
I forgot I was either on the show or Riz. In the chat room.
Riz.
To answer the question, though, I kind of agree on the side of Mad Mike on this one. It would totally affect how they run things and how – and maybe have that union happen and maybe get those 3 months off and 6 months on or whatever the thing was. I'm not sure. I suck at math. But I just feel like it would like AJ Lee or CM Punk would get the time off that they need. And maybe this show would, you know, kind of, nuts, you know, and maybe our show would be knocked down just a bit, but I don't think in a whole that the podcasting realm would be affected, because even though those ESPN does cover it, if something like ESPN covers wrestling, there's still going to be those little side projects like what we do here for the Wrestling Mayhem Show, just like there is for, you know, I believe there is stuff for, like, football talk and hockey talk and stuff like that. will it be, you know, lessened and will we know more about it? Yeah, but it's more fun to, it's fun to talk about still. Mm-hmm. And that's why we get together every Tuesday, because it's fun to talk about. We don't say, hey guys, breaking news. We don't say that. We don't say stuff like that because we just have fun. And that's why we're here. Some other people, like, I don't want to name any tweets or tweeters or anything like that, but like the breaking the stories before they happen suck. They suck. But having that transparency would probably kill those guys off. Like, but as for us, we still would be doing stuff and having more fun since they're not there and they're getting our audience and we're getting their audience. So fuck them guys. But yeah, it's just to the point where I just feel like it would be healthier if it was more transparent and the fans did know a lot of what's going on. Mm-hmm. That's pretty much it.
All right. Well, with that, let me see what we got here. If anybody's in the chat room, I don't know. Is the chat room alive? Okay. Anyways,
we're all on.
You're all in here. That's right. Everybody rolled off when Sarah left. I see how it is. Sorry, I was actually going through a few things. We had a lot of comments. We don't use the YouTube comments, but apparently some other people are that found us tonight. So sorry about that.
Hi YouTube.
We are on the YouTube, so it's true. But anyways, so let us know what you think of the big question. Particularly what if it was 100% and everything like that. And let's see. Last week. Oh, if you hit us on the big question, you will get, I got my notes here, IWC's Best of 2014. This includes guys like Matt Hardy is on there. Our friends of the show, like Facade, doing some great, great matches. Andrew Palace, and it's the very best. Dalton Castle is making waves over there. Ring of Honor, of course. Yes, all over the place. So go check that out. It's actually not even released yet. We're releasing it this week on PittsburghWrestling.com and IWCWrestling.com. Bring a few copies to Meadville for the Night of the Superstars 4. But you'll get it here next week if you answer with hashtag WMS Big Question on the Twitter. Follow at Mayhem Show, and you'll have a chance to win that from PittsburghWrestling.com. Now, this past week, last week's big question was discussing, oh no, what was it? RWA March to Victory was the... that was my question too, wasn't it? Oh, what was the thing that made you stand up in wrestling lately? Or last mm-hmm. thing, like, what was a big memory of, you know, what? Because we were all reacting to WrestleMania, standing up, yes, Seth Rollins, yes, Jen Carlin's breaking her hand on her ceiling because she got up so quick, you know, that kind of situation. So we got a few responses from that, which is really awesome. First of all, from old OG Mayhemmer, Chad the Shad, Spear. When Edge came back from injury to enter the Royal Rumble and won.
We mentioned that earlier tonight.
Sorry, LB. Another one from Kyle says, Eddie Edwards being out of action, how long will it take? Wait, this is actually another question. I don't know why he's answering. Occupy Pro Wrestling, Pirate of Sparks, a friend Alex says, he had a good answer to the big question until Seth Rollins went and stole it from it. Right. We had one from our friend Gabriel via email. What made me ride on my seat? Maven eliminating Big Evil Taker. Brock Lesnar. Oh, I don't want to. Okay, I'll say this one the way it's written. Brock Lesnar going full retard, shooting star press.
Oh.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah. Taker throwing Mankind off the Hell in a Cell, of course. Mm-hmm. Eddie's memorial on Raw. I rose up and clapped for 5 minutes to honor him, my favorite wrestler. So awesome. Thank you for the responses, as off color as some of them may be. So you guys will be picking up the ones that actually answered this question. I don't know where this other one came from. We'll be getting March to Victory 2015 with that big last man standing match between intergender, between Mickey Knuckles and Nicholas Esteban Taylor, and I make a cameo yelling at wrestlers. I checked it out a couple days ago. You hear me. Yes. It's basically me going, no, shit. Yes, they got a little too close. But hashtag WS big question for your chance to win. Of course, best of. And of course, please check us out, prowrestlingtees.com/WMS. Support the show. Get some cool threads. A lot of fun stuff on there. And of course, we got a Spreadshirt where, of course, the Mayhem Club t-shirts, because you're still allowed to make gimmick-infringing Bullet Club shirts over on Spreadshirt. So just a quick one there. Just a quick reminder. So let's get into the fan mails. Gabriel emailed us. And Eamon, didn't mean to hurt your feelings. LOL.
LOL.
It was a miss last week. He told us like whose voice on the show annoys him the most and such. So,
And least.
Anyways.
Yes, Riz, you're a badass.
You're such a badass.
Riz is number one fan right here. First off, guys, I post videos on the Facebook group, so you can see me talk. I'm not Riz. However, I look a little bit like Mad Mike, but I sound different. Okay.
I like that he didn't say better in either of those regards.
He's getting your good graces. I knew the question Mad Mike gave was a sarcastic question. I enjoy playing along with you guys. Are badass. One question to Bobby. Okay. Who has the best personality? My answer, Eamon. That was Bobby's question. I'm sorry. What was the personality? Question. And Eamon has the best personality. At least he got 2 out of 3, bro.
Okay, let me try this again. Who is the funniest?
Well, Bobby, that's probably just going to be LB.
Yeah, probably.
That's sweet. I have a better question.
In that last month when he wasn't here.
No. Lunchbox, what is your question?
Who has the best testicles?
God damn it.
Keep in mind, mine are bronze.
He also goes on, best voice, Sorg. I got one. Best look, Eamon. Look at you!
We established this.
Your fussy hair there. Like this is this, you got
who
the.
Are you, who are you indifferent to?
You got Eamon woke up like this.
No, he really woke up like
best
that.
Best personality, yeah. Eamon. Also, Eamon, you're growing on me. The more I watch you, smiley face.
Rip yeah, right. Eamon. Get that cookie. Wait.
Eamon. I think you're his favorite now.
Yeah, Riz. It's got some competition.
He's no badass.
I'm no badass.
No.
You've grown accustomed to your face. That's
the best. Wow.
He wants your face. Amen.
I don't even know. So apparently we also got a voicemail here. Did anybody listen to this? Did anybody vet this one? I need to put one of you guys on vetting these things.
Nope.
Oh, I was doing the
show.
All right. This is from Antonio Garza.
Jesus. I'm going to punch him.
He has the real best voice.
Stop threatening. He's definitely the best voice for covering Lucha Underground. Holy crap.
Yeah.
By the way, maybe we four actors.
All right, guys, you ready? Ready? Here we go.
Wrestling Mayhem Show. It is I02K. I am calling today because I am too lazy to send an email.
What?
So to answer last big question from last week. Moment that made me stand up, Alberto Rio winning the Royal Rumble. I was the only heel Mexican at the bar, and it got really, really awkward. Raw last night, didn't watch it. It was boring. Only watched 1 hour. The Jericho podcast, it sounded really, really controlled and scripted. But it was good. I liked it. New Japan Pro Wrestling Invasion Attack, it was amazing. Go watch it. Pause the show. Go watch it now. And the real reason I'm calling in, I want to open a challenge. I want to make a challenge to every member of the Wrestling Mayhem Nation of Domination. You see, I've been a Patreon for over a year now.
Yes.
And I just don't think I'm doing enough. So what I want from April 8th to May 8th, I want to challenge each and every one of you. Riz, Bobby, Launchbox, AJ, well, you're already there.
And
all the fans and all the guests that we have each week. I want to challenge you to become a patron for 1 month. in 1 year, AJ and I haven't done much as we wish we would. But I know if in 1 month we all pitch in, we can make a big change. So I challenge you all. I hope I'll see you at Patreon site. Later's Mayhem. Heel Garza out.
Well, I did, Ray. So I'm out.
Yeah, you're all right.
Yep.
You did it for
a month.
3 weeks, didn't you?
You only did it so you could fuck up Mayhem Mania.
The one thing I asked you to do, and you fucking dropped the ball.
I had no control over that.
What?
Yeah. It was already turned into a Hell in a Cell. Yeah.
And you could have fixed it.
You could have
Don't think I didn't follow while I was gone, motherfucker.
You aren't allowed to take off stipulations.
What?
You aren't allowed to take off stipulations.
No, that was fine.
That was fine.
Just the match had to stay intact.
You could have. They changed the match. You were in a perfect position to change it back. Cheats.
I stand by my
cheats.
Let's bring this around. You know what? You still got to own up, Mad Mike, because you got to. Let's see. We're still on the Impact question mark watch.
Well, I did watch. So there's the question. They had this thing called Bell to Bell this week.
Yeah, I saw the tweets for this. What was this about?
No Bella, idea.
Bella to Bella.
No idea. They never explained it, Sword. Not once did they say what the fuck Bell to Bell meant.
Okay.
If they meant it was nonstop action, they were wrong. I mean, there were three decent matches on it. Nothing I'd really write home about.
Okay.
And the Wolves have to give up the tag titles. Mm-hmm. Honestly, until there's a change in the world title scene, I'm going to be very down on it because Kurt Angle just needs to stop. He needs to stop. He needs to pass the torch on to someone. He needs to go into the Hall of Fame and retire.
He's already in the Hall of Fame.
He needs to go into the real Hall of Fame, not the one with three people in it.
All active wrestlers, by the way.
Yes. All active wrestlers and all wrestlers Ethan Carter has defeated.
There you go. There's real Hall of Fame. All right. So there you go. Impact Bell Watch. That's done.
Impact Bell Watch. You're just going to change that middle word every week, aren't you, Sorg?
Shh. Don't reveal the gimmick.
Sorg, you wanted more transparency.
Ow.
Wow.
Damn it.
Wow. That was loud.
Oh. I know.
You're trying to wake up everybody from that Impact Watch.
I know.
Exactly.
What happens? What I miss?
The Penguins lost, Bobby.
Oh. God damn it. Thor and Martin.
Oh, so sad. Okay. So sad. On that note, I guess it's time to learn, find out what we learned from wrestling this week. Right, guys?
I guess so.
You guess so? What do you got, Papa Lunchbox, your first week back here?
Oh, it's my first week back, and you're starting with me.
Well, what did you learn from your month off?
That was on Awesome Cast.
That was Awesome Cast.
Oh, okay.
What did I learn?
Mad Mike, what'd you learn this week?
I learned that Dario Cueto makes really awesome trios teams. And I'm super excited about a Trios title belt.
I heard you guys talking about that on a Midweek War this week. I'm excited for it, too. I want to check it out. So I saw the belt, so awesome.
The belts are very pretty.
They are. What about you, Bobby?
I learned that Adrian Neville is a better version of the Hurricane.
Wow.
I like the Hurricane, don't get me wrong, but he's like a more serious future version of the Hurricane.
So he's the DC New 52 Hurricane?
No, he's the Marvel Hurricane.
Okay.
Nothing DC about it.
What about you, Eamon?
I learned that when it came to fully living Raw announced theme, Michael Cole was the problem, apparently.
Once fully living?
Wow.
Because last night's commentary was pretty good. Maybe it was Michael Cole. I don't know.
Wow. What about you, LB?
Hey.
Riz, what'd you learn?
He's out of practice. It's okay.
Riz, what'd you learn?
I really am.
Did you learn anything about John Cena?
I would say I learned that he's a fan of the Chive, but I already knew that he was a fan of the Chive. I learned that Chris Jericho is fooling himself, because he thinks that little, that strange little cord is going to work as an effective scarf.
Wow. What about you, Riz?
I learned that with John Cena, anything can be fixed. Even a broken marriage.
Oh, wow.
Multiple.
From the social medias over on the Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook page, Gabriel learned that the WWE makes fantastic heels and not so great faces. And I think there's a list somewhere, too. I think I'm going to get to that in a second. Also, from the Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook group, where a lot of the conversation is happening, you guys want to hop in there if you want to be part of that. Matt Harlins learned... Oh, wait, this is another conversation. Wait, what's happening? Garza learned that the tag teams are the biggest type of bonding, and not even Bull Club can make Kenny forget about the good days of Ibushi?
New Japan Pro Wrestling.
Okay. Carlin's tap new, tap day, tap sucks.
Yep.
Alex Carr's learned that, yeah.
They still kind of suck.
New.
Alex Carr's learned that the clapping is an effective anger answer management therapy, the angry therapy. Gabriel elaborates on his fantastic heels and boring faces in WWE. I mean, look at the heels: Rollins, Wyatt, Rusev, Stardust, Bad News Barrett, and Ambrose, kinda. And for faces, it's Cena, Reigns, Bryan, and Orton. I guess is good. So there you go.
I would contend Wyatt should be in there as a good heel.
I think he should.
Really?
We'll agree to disagree.
Still the face of fear, even though I lost it, man. Yeah.
Hey, like I said,
you gotta do something about it.
Like I said on the Hangout, where is Taker?
Where is Taker?
He's gone.
He's there.
Where is Taker?
So he's stepping up.
Carlin's also learned that New Japan Pro Wrestling cameramen are powerless to resist inappropriate close-ups whenever they're in the presence of scantily clad women. And Garza responds, but sell. And
Hashtag Japan.
Also, I love that if you look up at Mayhem Show on the search, like the pictures are Serafini, Peeps, and the Sheamus Mohawk.
Mm-hmm.
Like that's our images right now.
That sounds accurate.
That sounds about right. Ladies, Peeps, and Mohawks. Anyways, on that point, hey, thank you, Serafini, for joining us. Let me double check the chat, make sure I didn't miss anything in there. But thank you for everybody that dropped in there, including WrestlingRevolution.com and Wheels, of course. We gotta get Wheels back on. I keep forgetting to roll him in too. I keep forgetting about Riz. I did not mean to do that.
You made the same joke in the chat room, so it's okay.
I know it is. He makes worse jokes.
I really missed you guys.
No, you guys don't understand. He really does make work.
Oh, yes, he does.
Like, you think we're bad.
Yeah. Yeah, it gets pretty rough. Do a show with them. Anyways, if I was to join, hey, I'll be up in Meadville, PA for IWC's Night of the Superstars 4, my kind of homestead. So if you went to high school with me and you haven't left town, you can say hi.
Sorg.
What?
Bobby I, and Lunchbox, if I remember that correctly, are going to be at Steel City Con this week.
Yes, he is.
There you go.
And if you see any of them and recognize them as part of the wrestling name,
say
hi and shake their hand.
Yeah.
You guys should have a meetup out there or something.
And ask if you can shop them.
No.
I'm just saying, ask.
No. What was
it that I always said to do to Eamon if you saw him at a show?
Shop
him. Suck my dick.
Yeah. That's true.
It really is.
Yeah, but I can't remember how I put it. It was something like say hello to his penis with your mouth or something like that. I can't remember.
Wow.
You may continue our outro.
We missed you too, LB.
By the way, I don't usually get this, but thank you everybody that dropped feedback. Not all of it positive, but thank you for the input of us talking with Serafini earlier today. So already seeing that stuff rolled in. But you can join us here. Of course, we're at live.sorgatronmedia.com, live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com, around with the 9 p.m. at Wrestling PM. That's what it is. 9 p.m. Eastern Time. You can join us and be a part of this. So, yeah, I saw some people had comments on the YouTube feed. We don't use that. We do not use the YouTube chat comment system. It just doesn't work for us, but apparently it's there, and we can't shut it off. So there's that. Nope. So, yeah, and thank you everybody that's joined us. Stay tuned. We got who we got on Indie Mayhem Show tonight?
We have the returning Evangelistico. We've had him back on Indie Mayhem Show. He's also been on some other Sorgatron Media podcasts. So, yes. It'll be good to have him back. Good to have him talking about some wrestling.
Awesome. And of course, check everything out. WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Drops the line 412-206-WMS0 or Good Time. Good Time. WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Until next time, Mayhem Show out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com.